So today I'm going to look at cell physiology. So focus on the same topic that you had. You said you had challenges with the one you had learned or read from school. So when it comes to cell physiology, basically here we are going to talk about the body fluid compartment. So when it comes to body fluid compartments and the solutes found in a human being, the human being is composed of around or about 18% of proteins in the body. And apart from that, it is in relation with the substances in terms of weight, which is about 7% minerals, 15% fat, which is composed in weight. Then apart from that, 60% of a human being is made up of water in weight as well. And this means that this 60% of water is in relation to an average adult male who is of the weight of about 70 kg. Apart from that, we have two major fluid compartments. And when it comes to the two major fluid compartments, we have the intracellular fluids as well as the extracellular fluids. So when it comes to the intracellular fluids, these are the fluids which are found inside the cells. Then extracellular fluids are those found outside the cell, as well as other metabolic processes that should take place outside the cell. So when it comes to the extracellular fluids, these are fluids which are found in spaces like the interstitial spaces, fluids, as well as the transcellular fluids. So these are the fluids that makes up the extracellular fluids compartments. And then when it comes to the intracellular fluids, these they make up or they account of about 40% of the total body weight, while the extracellular fluids make up of around 20% of the total body weight. So when it comes to the extracellular, the fluid compartments, this is what I'm talking about. So you have about 42 liters total amount of fluids in the body. So amongst that, for the 2 liters, 28 liters is found inside the cell, which is the intracellular fluid, making up 2/3 of the total body weight. Then when it comes to the extracellular fluids, it makes up of about 14 liters out of the 42 liters. And this makes up 1/3 of the total body weight. So from the same extracellular fluids, this is where we are saying from the extracellular fluids, we have interstitial fluids, plasma, as well as transcellular fluids. And interstitial fluids is about 10.5 liters, making up 3/3 of extracellular fluids, while plasma makes up 1/4 of extracellular fluids, which is about 3 liters. Then transcellular fluids makes up 0.5 liters or a quarter, I mean half a liter of extracellular fluids. Okay. So apart from that, we can look at the factors that we can move on to the factors affecting body fluids. When it comes to factors that affect amount of fluids in the body, we can talk of age. So when it comes to age, you find that an infant or a baby has more fluid as compared to an older aged individual. This is because an infant is going to be made up of about between 73 to 80% of fluids on the entire body as compared to an adult who may have about 45% of the total body being made up of fluids. Then when it comes to sex, male adults, they are made up of about 55 to 60% of fluids as compared to female adults who are made up of or who may have about 45 to 50% of fluids inside their body. Then apart from that, the other factors that may affect body fluids are effects of obesity. So when it comes to effects of obesity, so apart from that, the other factors that may affect body fluid compartment or amount is obesity, the effects of obesity. So you may find that an individual may end up having excess amount of fluids because of being obese. Apart from that, we have other climate level of physical activities where in terms of maybe someone who is too active, maybe let's say someone who wakes out or staying in a warm environment, you may find that these individuals are going to have less fluids because of their actual activities or their tenders of activities utilizing a lot of water through other metabolic processes involved in being active or utilization of muscles. So those are just the percentages of water or fluids in the body. Apart from that, we can move on to other compartment, which is the functions of body fluids. So when it comes to functions of body fluids, the first function is that the body fluids can be used as a medium for transport. This is where all other nutrients, oxygen, and other micro nutrients that are needed by the body are transported through this body fluids. And basically, metabolic processes, they take place through this same body fluids. Apart from that, they are also needed for cellular metabolism. So for breakdown of food content, as well as processing of other nutrients in the body, these things are done in this same body fluids. Apart from that, these body fluids can be used or are used for electrolytes and other constituents. So they are used as solvents, meaning they need to be used in mixtures of other solutes so that you don't have a higher concentration of a particular solute in the body. Then apart from that, they are also used to help maintain body temperature. So you'll find that when it is hot, you're going to lose a lot of water because the body is trying to maintain a particular homeostasis for your body so that you don't overheat and die. So you are the fluids in the body are also used to maintain the body temperature. Apart from that, they are also used for their help. They help in terms of digestion. You will find that when you are constipated, digestion is impaired. So that is another function or importance of having body fluids because they help in digestion. They also help in elimination through sweating. You find that waste products are eliminated. Apart from that, through urination, as well as through fecal matter, feces also contain water or fluids or body fluids, which also help eliminate fecal content or urine or sweat. In that manner, they eliminate waste materials from the body. Then fluids are also used as a lubricant. For example, let's take an example of saliva. When you want to swallow food, the saliva is utilized as a lubricant so that you swallow food content without injuring your GIT or also with the ease. So these are some of the examples that I can give you or can be utilized or can be used as functions of body fluids in the body. Then apart from that, when it comes to the mechanism of how we gain or lose body fluids per day, this is in relation to fluid gain, which is about 2,800 mils, which you should gain in a particular day as compared to the loss, which is around 2.7 liters in a particular day. So when it comes to fluid intake, you need to take in about direct intake of fluid, which is about 1,500 mils, which is 1.5 liters. Then from the foods that we eat, you also should take in about 1 liter of fluids. Then apart from that, from oxidation of nutrients, you can take in about 300 mils, then about 10 mils of water comes from around 100 calories of food content or nutrients that we take in. So when you add up all those fluids, you find that that is the amount of it will go to around 2.8 liters of fluids that you should take in a single day. But when it comes to fluid loss, we lose around 2,700 mils, which is about 2.7 liters of fluids that we lose. And from sensible loss, we can lose around 1.5 mils or 1.5 liters of fluids from urinating, which is a lot of fluids, which is the major source of loss of fluids in the body. Mm-hmm. Apart from that, from sweating, we lose about 100 mils just from sweat. Then from other insensible loss like evaporation, which is on the skin, we lose around 500 mils. Then also from the lungs through respiration and other activities, we lose about 400 mils. And then from feces also, we lose around 200 mils. That's why replacement of fluids is very, very important, so that you replace the lost fluids. Because we lose a lot of fluids, which is around 2.7 liters in a particular day. So when it comes to loss of fluids, fluids are also regulated, especially water in the body. It is regulated, which is in relation to loss as compared to the amount of water that you are gaining. So when it comes to gain is largely by volume of water intake. So this means that you need to take in a lot of water through oral intake, because this is the major source of gain of water. Then apart from that, so the major source of water is through intake, meaning oral intake. So this is because in the body we have the thirst centers in the hypothalamus, and once they are stimulated, they are going to increase water intake. So whenever it is hot, you realize that the hypothalamus, which is the thirst center, they are easily stimulated, so that you drink in a lot of water. And this is the one of ways through which we gain water as well as other solutes. In terms of loss is largely through urine, and this is used to regulate intake and as compared to the output, so that you don't have excess of this amount of fluids. Apart from that, in terms of loss, we have three hormones that regulate the renal sodium as well as chloride reabsorption. So when it comes to the renal system, in the renal system you have a center which regulates the amount of fluids or the amount of reabsorption of sodium as well as chloride. Because where sodium goes, water follows. So when sodium is reabsorbed, meaning there'll be a lot of water being reabsorbed in the body. But in terms of the angiotensin II, you have again renin in the renal system or in the kidneys, which is secreted whenever you have low volumes of blood or fluid in other words. So when you have low volume of fluids or low urine output, renin is going to be secreted from the kidneys. So when the renin is secreted from the kidneys or the renal system, it is going to convert angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2, which helps constrict the blood vessels so as to increase the pressure of fluids in the body. Apart from that, aldosterone is also secreted. Once secreted, sodium and chloride reabsorption is improved, meaning fluid uptake is improved. So when the body is losing a lot of sodium as well as chloride, meaning you are going to lose a lot of fluids. When the body is producing a lot of renin and converting a lot of angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2, meaning a lot of sodium is going to be reabsorbed. Therefore, even loss of urine is going to be reduced. But if there is no angiotensin 2, meaning sodium is going to be lost in the body, as well as if there's no aldosterone, meaning sodium is going to be lost in the body. And as you lose sodium as well as chloride, meaning you're also going to lose a lot of water or fluids or other electrolytes. Then the other mechanism is by use of arteriosclerotic peptide, which also controls or regulates fluid loss in the body. Other hormones that regulate fluid loss is vasopressin, which is released also from the posterior pituitary gland. This one also regulates the amount of fluid that you lose in a single day. So as compared to the amount that you have, as well as the amount that you may lose. So when it comes to implication of fluid balance, here there is a balance between body fluids and electrolytes in compartments. So you need to have a balance between the amount of fluids in the body as well as electrolytes, because if there's an imbalance, you're going to have a shift of fluids as well as electrolytes, and then you are going to see that as edema or ascites if it accumulates in the peritoneal cavities or other compartments. So meaning you need to have an equal amount of fluids as compared to the equal amount of solutes so as to avoid this imbalance. So apart from that, you find that the attraction between electrolytes and fluid causes fluid to move across membranes and leave their compartment. And then when there are disturbances in fluid balance, this can either be hypovolemia or hypervolemia. So whenever there is a disturbance in fluid in the body, you can go into hypovolemia, meaning reduced volume levels of fluids in the body, or hypervolemia, where you have excess amount of fluid volume in the body, which is a problem according to the normal physiological functioning of a human being. So water is the most important nutrient for life and is the primary body fluid. When you compare water to biochemists, we say it is almost used in all biochemical processes as well as helping maintain life. This is because water is the reason why as human being we even live or survive, because if water was overheating, we would have been dying easily. As soon as the temperature reaches a certain degree, would also overheat and die. But because water resists warming easily or boiling easily, well, this is the reason why we survive, and this is why water is the most important nutrient for life. So when you lose about 10% of body fluid, this equals to about 8% weight loss, and this is very serious. So just losing 10% of your fluid in the body, you are going to lose about 8% of your total body weight, and this is going to be very, very serious in terms of your life, or losing weight as compared to your life. Then loss of about 20% of body fluids equals to about 15% weight loss, and this is very fatal. Then apart from that, you'll find that fluid gained each day should be equal to the fluid lost each day. And this is approximate about 2 to 3 liters in a single day. So we lose and gain or fluids of about 2 to 3 liters. Therefore, we should replace an equal amount of fluid lost as compared to the gain, so that we don't lose much, which may affect the livelihood of a particular human being. Okay, so we can move on to fluid concentration. When it comes to fluid concentration, we have what we call osmolarity, which is a pulling force. So the osmolarity, or the osmotic pressure, this is the pressure that maintains or help keep intracellular fluids inside the cells, as well as extracellular fluids outside the cells. So this osmotic pressure, for example, when you look at albumin as well as plasma protein, these are some of the things that are used to maintain the osmotic pressure so that you don't have a shift of fluids coming out of the cell to the outside of the cell. Then apart from that, when the concentration of these fluids changes, meaning you are going to have a shift of fluids. So the normal serum osmolarity is around 208 to 295 molar osmos per liters. Apart from that, a solution in the body that is being injected in a human being can be hypertonic, or can be hypotonic, or isotonic. So when it comes to hypotonic solutions, you have 0.45% normal saline, as well as 0.33% normal saline, which can be called hypotonic solutions. Then isotonic solution, you have the common 0.9% normal saline, as well as Ringer's lactate. These are isotonic solutions, meaning they are neither hypertonic or hypotonic, but they are just standard fluids. Then apart from that, we have serum protein, for example, albumin. Albumin helps maintain the colloid pressure, and this helps also maintain the fluid concentration by maintaining the osmotic pressure in the body so that there's no fluid shift in the body. Then albumin pulls water from the interstitial fluid compartment into serum and helps maintain the blood pressure. So whenever you have low serum albumin levels, this means that it will result in to retain of fluids in their interstitial layers in that particular manner. Then when it comes to functions of important electrolytes that we have in the body, we can talk of sodium. When it comes to sodium, potassium, calcium, as well as magnesium, these are important cations in the body which are needed to maintain the fluid electrolyte level. So when it comes to sodium, as well as chloride, these are found outside the cell. Then inside the cell, we are going to find magnesium. Then potassium is also found inside the cell, as well as other electrolytes, so as to maintain the fluid balance. Then apart from that, you have anions like phosphate, as well as bicarbonates, which are also important in the body to maintain the pH, as well as the body fluid osmolarity. So when it comes to sodium and chloride, these, they regulate water distribution in the body. Then apart from that, when it comes to potassium as well as calcium, they are mainly concentrated in the muscles, and they help in contraction of the muscles so that you're able to move your limbs, breathe in and out, and also move other muscles in the body. Then apart from that, potassium, calcium, as well as sodium, they also help in nerve impulse transmission. So for you to effectively have a level-headed brain or something of cognitive function, you need to have sodium, potassium, as well as calcium enough in the body so as to maintain the normal nerve impulse transmission in the body. And then potassium is also utilized in blood clotting. And then apart from that, magnesium is utilized in regulation of enzyme reaction, meaning formation of ATP energy in the body. And then hydrogen as an electrolyte is also utilized in regulation of acid-base balance. When it comes to respiration, you realize that hydrogen is very important to regulate whether the body is acidic or is alkalinic, or maintaining the acid-base balance so that you don't become too acidic, which can result in degeneration of our body cells. So apart from that, when it comes to extracellular fluids, so extracellular fluids is still in the internal environment inside the body, but this is the fluid found outside the cell. So the extracellular fluid is in constant motion throughout the body and transported rapidly in the circulating blood, and then mixed between the blood and the tissue fluids by the diffusion through the capillary walls. Then apart from that, you find that the extracellular fluid has ions as well as nutrients needed by the cells to maintain the cell life. Thus, all cells live in essentially the same environment, which is the internal environment of the body, but they swim through a fluid which we call the extracellular fluids. So the cells are capable of living, growing, as well as performing their special functions as long as the proper concentration of oxygen, glucose, different ions, as well as amino acids, fatty substances, and other constituents are available in the extracellular fluids. So fundamentally, you find that all organs as well as tissue in the body, they perform functions that help maintain homeostasis or normal level functioning of the body. Then apart from that, the body systems perform homeostatic functions, and some systems supply nutrients in the extracellular fluids, as well as the liver and other organs to perform their metabolic functioning, because metabolism or breakdown of nutrients or other body substances, you need extracellular fluids and other fluids to facilitate these processes. Apart from that, including removal of metabolic waste, as well as regulation of the body and reproduction, you need extracellular fluid present in the body so that these processes are facilitated. Then extracellular fluid is also utilized in terms of blood circulation. So in blood circulation, this is concerned with extracellular fluid transport as well as mixing system. So you're going to see blood going to the lungs for oxygenation and also leaving the lungs to the rest of the body. And this blood is an example of an extracellular fluid utilized in transportation as well as mixing system in the body. Then in terms of the respiratory system, you see pickup of oxygen in the alveoli and then acquiring of oxygen needed by the cells, as well as excretion of carbon dioxide. In the GIT, different nutrients dissolve in a fluid, and apart from that, the extracellular fluid is also utilized in absorption of nutrients in the GIT or from the food that is ingested. And these new fluids, they help absorb these nutrients taken into the extracellular fluid compartment. And then the extracellular fluid is going to be used to supply those nutrients to the rest of the body. Then when it comes to the liver also changes the chemical composition of many of the absorbed substances from the GIT to more usable forms and other tissues of the body. So you find that by the means of presence of extracellular fluids, the chemical composition of many absorbed substances are broken down or changed from the GIT, and then so these substances that are coming from the GIT, because all the nutrients that are utilized by the rest of the body are absorbed from the GIT, and then the liver is going to use certain components to the chemical components to change certain things into usable forms of nutrients by the body cells or the body tissue. Then apart from that, the musculoskeletal system also needs nutrients for it to move the body appropriately. So apart from that, the musculoskeletal system also obtain the food required for nutrition and for security of the system, such as its strength, its ability to contract and relax and to make all the movements that a human being should make. It acquires those nutrients through the extracellular fluid compartment in the body. Then the kidneys also help remove contents or waste materials. And these waste materials are materials which are not needed by the body for it to function normally. And the kidneys are going to move those things. So when you look at the kidney, you have the nephrons there, which help sieve the blood for waste materials. And these waste materials are released out of the body as urine. Then the nervous system, as well as hormones, which are used for communication and coordination of the body, they also receive their nutrients and whatever they need for them to function normally through the same extracellular fluids. So when it comes to the characteristics of control system of the body, we have the negative feedback control system as well as the positive feedback control system. So when it comes to the negative feedback, the negative feedback control system here, the principle of negative feedback mechanism is that whenever there is a deviation from a given normal set point, which are detected by a sensor, as well as signals from the sensor triggers compensatory changes that continue until a set point is again reached. So what this means is that whenever there's a discrepancy from the normal, let's say you are supposed to have a normal amount of blood pressure, which should be between the systolic, which should be between 100 and 140 beats per minute. So whenever there is a discrepancy, let's say you have below 100 beats per minute, meaning the body is going to give or send a negative signal. So as for the body to respond to that negative signal and improve the blood pressure. So whenever you have a discrepancy where your body doesn't have enough fluids, or you have subnormal amount of fluids in your body, meaning a negative signal is going to be initiated so as the body to do something and improve the fluid level. When it comes to the positive feedback control system, here the mechanisms are designed to accelerate or enhance the output created by a stimulus that has already been detected. So for example, if you have enough blood in your body, meaning a positive feedback control system is going to be initiated so that you lose a lot of fluid so as to maintain homeostasis. Apart from that, you may injure yourself, then you are losing blood, and a positive system is going to be initiated so as to clot the blood where you are bleeding from, so that you don't lose enough blood in the body, and this helps maintain normal amount of extracellular fluids in the body. Then apart from that, how can we measure the body fluid compartments? So when it comes to the body fluids compartments, these are measured using a dye which can be injected in a particular compartment, and then you measure whatever is being found in the other compartment. So apart from that, these dyes, they are non-toxic, they do not perform metabolic activities, because if you inject a dye which performs metabolic activity, meaning it is going to be utilized by the body, and then you won't get the correct amount of fluid that should be found in that particular compartment. So when it comes to the dilution principle, so the dilution principle uses the principle of mass conservation, and this one is based on using a dye whose concentration can be measured. So meaning if you inject an X amount of gram of a marker in a compartment, and then from there you measure the concentration at equilibrium, meaning you're going to measure another Y grams of fluid or dye or concentration, and this Y amount of fluid should be measured in liters. So meaning when you want to measure concentration of a fluid, you're going to say concentration equals to mass over volume, and mass, it is going to be an X amount of grams injected in a compartment divided by the volume recorded. Meaning from here, you can also measure volume because you need to have volume in for you to measure concentration. So you can calculate volume as volume equals to mass over concentration, meaning you need to have the X amount of grams as well as the Y amount of grams measured in liters. So from here, you can have you can also measure extracellular fluid and plasma volume, which can be measured with the formula volume equals to mass over concentration. So if you want to measure plasma, amount of plasma in the body, or amount of extracellular fluid, you're going to say volume equals to mass over concentration. However, when it comes to intracellular as well as the interstitial fluids, this cannot be measured but can be calculated. So when it comes to intracellular fluid volume, this one can be measured by total body weight, then you subtract the extracellular fluid volume, meaning you are going to get the amount of fluids being found inside the cells. Then when it comes to the interstitial fluid volume, here for you to get the amount of fluids being found between body tissues, you need to subtract plasma volume from extracellular volume, then you are going to get the amount of volume being found in between the body tissue. So here, when it comes to question one, this one is saying, explain in real life situations conditions in which there is addition and subtraction of following in the body, as well as consequences thereof. And concentration, meaning fluid and concentration. And part A is talking about isotonic solution, hypotonic solution, as well as hypertonic solution. So here you need to talk about a condition where you have isotonic solution. What condition, what pathological condition can you see isotonic solution, someone having isotonic solution? And then what pathological conditions can you see where a patient has hypotonic solution? For example, when someone is dehydrated, meaning the solution are going to reduce in number. I mean hypertonic, meaning highly concentrated solution. So when you are dehydrated, your urine is going to be highly concentrated. But when you are overhydrated, you're going to have a hypotonic or less concentrated solution. So these are some of the things that needs to be discussed. So this one is more straightforward, but our focus is going to be on the second questions which require calculations. So when it comes to these calculations, question one is saying 115 milligrams of sucrose is injected into a 70 kilogram man. The plasma sucrose level after mixing is 0.01 milligrams per mil. If 5 milligrams has been metabolized during this period, then what is the extracellular fluid volume? So this question requires you to calculate the extracellular fluid volume. So how can we calculate the extracellular fluid volume? So when it comes to calculating the extracellular fluid volume, we can utilize the same formulas that we have been given. So if you focus on the question that we have been given, the question is saying 115 milligram of sucrose is injected into 70 kg man. So meaning the amount of sucrose injected is 115 milligrams rather. So 115 milligrams has been injected. So 115 milligrams has been injected. And then from there, the question goes on to say the concentration of plasma after mixing is 0.01 milligrams per mil, meaning we have a concentration already given, which is 0.01 milligrams per mil. But and then the question goes on to say, if 5 milligrams has been metabolized during this period, what is the extracellular fluid concentration? So when you look at this question, we have been told 5 milligrams amount remaining in extracellular fluid, meaning 5 milligrams from the 115 milligrams sucrose injected was utilized. So 5 milligrams has already been used. So amount metabolized, we have been told it is 5 milligrams, meaning 5 milligrams has already been used. So how much is remaining? So you find that the amount remaining in the extracellular fluid part A is 110 milligrams. So when you subtract 5 milligrams from the 115 injected, you're going to remain with 110 milligram concentration of sucrose remaining. Therefore, you're going to say when we get our formula for extracellular fluid, which says ECF volume is equal to mass over concentration, meaning our mass, you're going to put the mass, which is 110 milligrams per mil, divided by the concentration, and our concentration is 0.01 milligrams per mil. So when you calculate this, when you do the calculation, you are going to get 11,000 mils, but the answer should be in liters and not mils. So when you convert 11,000 mils, you are going to get 11 liters, meaning the normal amount of extracellular fluid is going to give you 11 liters in the extracellular based on these figures given in this scenario. So that's how you can come up with the answer in this particular scenario. Then the second scenario is saying if the if 1 mL of solution, and this 1 mL of solution has a concentration of 20 milligrams per mL of dye is dispersed in chamber X, and final concentration in chamber X is 0.01 mL, what is the volume in chamber X? So here, and this formula wants us to find the volume in chamber X. So coming up with the volume in chamber X, looking at the formula provided in the slide, you'll find that the formula says an X amount of grams of a marker should be injected into a compartment, meaning here we have been told 1 mL of a solution which is concentrated of, which has a concentration of 20 milligrams per mL has been injected in a chamber X, and this is the same compartment injected in a compartment, and then measure the concentration at equilibrium, which is Y grams of a solution per liter, meaning we need to have our answer in liters. Therefore, we can measure concentration as equals to mass divided by volume. But here the question is saying we need to calculate the volume. Therefore, we can utilize this formula, which is coming from your slide, which is saying volume equals to mass over concentration. So when you look at the mass that we have been given, we have been told it is 1 mL, but this 1 mL has a concentration of 20 milligrams per mL, meaning this is what we are going to get as our mass. So when you say 20 milligrams per mL, and then you're going to divide this by the concentration, and the concentration we have been given, the concentration is 0.01 milligrams per mL. So you're going to divide 20 milligrams per mL by 0.01 milligrams per mL. When you do these calculations, you are going to get to arrive at the final answer, which is 2000 mL. But remember, the answer, the scenario, or the question, the formula is telling us that when we divide X grams divided by 1 Y grams, we should have our answer in liters and not in mL. So from 2000 mL, you just need to convert it to liters and you're going to get 2 liters, meaning the volume in chamber X is 2 liters. So that is how you can come up with answers to the scenarios that you have been given in this particular slide. So this is where we'll end in today's lesson.